Hi, my name is Alexander Bigerl. I am from the DICE research group at Paderborn University. Today, I will present to you our paper Hashing the Hypertrie, Space and Time-Efficient Indexing for SPARQL in Tensors. As you all know, triple stores are the backend of the semantic web. In recent years, a few approaches to build efficient triple stores based on tensors were brought up, though they all had some major drawbacks, like not covering all joins. At ISWC 2020, we showed how to overcome these limitations in our paper Tensors, a tensor-based triple store. Tensors is based on a novel tensor data structure dubbed Hypertrie. In several query stress tests, we showed that it can outperform state-of-the-art triple stores. But where there is light, there is also shadow. Tensors is very efficient in querying, but it simply requires too much memory. So we revisited the Hypertrie with the goal to reduce the storage footprint. Our approach was twofold. We looked for redundancies in the Hypertries that we could eliminate, and we also looked for storage overheads that could be reduced. And I would say it worked out pretty well. We could improve the storage footprint by up to 70% and even speed up querying by a factor of up to 7. I'll now shortly introduce the mapping from RDF to tensors. Consider this small RDF graph with a social network involving some entities that are pets. You can see along each RDF resource an integer. That's a unique ID for each resource. Using those IDs, we can compile a list of ID triples. We now use them to populate a tensor representation of the graph. For now, just think of a rank 3 tensor as a three-dimensional matrix with Boolean values. We set the entries at positions equal to ID triples to true and all others to false. The tensor representation of the graph above is plotted here in a Euclidean space. True values are dots. For example, the dots on the left are the type statements and the dots on the right are the nose statements. An important fact is that such RDF tensors are sparse by design. The Hypertrie is a data structure to store and access such sparse Boolean valued tensors. For the tensor operations necessary in RDF engines, it was built to allow efficient slicing by any dimension and to iterate non-zero slices by any dimension. Slicing is an operation where the indices for some dimensions are fixed to some values to retrieve the resulting matrix, vector or scalar. The memory efficiency listed here is what we strive to improve upon. On the bottom, you see a part of the RDF tensor for the graph from before. In the right top corner of each node, you see what slice it holds. For example, the top node contains the full RDF tensor. A Hypertrie node stores for each dimension references to all non-zero slices. The baseline Hypertrie uses a structural redundancy to reduce the storage complexity for maintaining all possible collation orders. As you can see on the right, when fixing the first two positions, it makes no difference which one you fix first. You will either way end up at the same leaf node, so storing it only once is always sufficient. That reduces the influence of the dimension on the storage bound from factorial to exponential. For triple data, this means that the worst case overhead is reduced from 6 to 4 times the number of triples. Now we come to the novel part of this work. While the theoretical bound seems fine, in practice the memory footprint is just too high. Our first finding was that Hypertries contain a large amount of duplicate nodes. Have a look at the two inner nodes at the right side. They encode the same rank 2 tensor but cannot be deduplicated by the baseline Hypertrie because they are from different slices. To deduplicate them, we must be able to tell if they are equivalent. This is achieved by a hash of their entries that we can use to identify and reference nodes. The respective node is then stored only once and referenced twice from the root node by its identifier I. How does the hashing work? Let a fixed order dependent hashing scheme for Hypertrie entries be given. To calculate the hash of a Hypertrie, we combine then the hashes of its entries with XOR. Because XOR is itself inverse, it is easy to update the hash when adding or removing an entry. The hash of the updated Hypertrie is simply the hash of the old Hypertrie XOR the hash of a new or removed entry. Our next optimization deals with inner nodes that contain a single entry. They come with a considerable overhead for maintaining mappings to child nodes and the child nodes themselves. We eliminate this overhead by introducing a new node type named single entry node. If a leaf node has only a single entry, we can even go a step further. As a matter of fact, the identifier of a node takes more memory than the payload of a single entry leaf node. We use this to completely eliminate these nodes and store the entry instead in the place where the reference to them would be stored otherwise. You can see that in the highlighted inner node. In its second dimension, slice keys are not mapped to nodes anymore, but to the single entries of the former leaf nodes. Before we go through the empirical evaluation, let's get a visual impression of how these optimizations shrink the hypertrie. Here you see the full baseline hypertrie for the exemplary data. You can see that it especially requires many leaf nodes, and I can tell you that there is a fair amount of duplicate and single entry nodes among them. Now let's have a look at the optimized hypertrie. It is clearly visible that the amount of nodes is drastically reduced. There is some less inner nodes and much less leaf nodes. This is a toy example, of course. Now let's have a look at an evaluation on some serious benchmarking datasets. For our evaluation, we used iguana-based stress tests to benchmark query performance. For each system, we used 30 runs on each dataset. As datasets, we used SWDF, a small real-world dataset with roughly 400,000 triples, DBpedia, a medium-large real-world dataset with about 700 million triples, WhatDiff, as a large synthetic dataset with 1 billion triples, and Wikidata, as a large real-world dataset with 5.5 billion triples. The queries used were select queries with a basic graph pattern, some of which have a distinct modifier. Queries for the real-world dataset were generated from query logs using the benchmark generation framework Feasible. On WhatDiff, we used the basic templates and added an additional distinct where it made sense. First, let's look at how the optimizations reduce the amount of full nodes and hypertries on the four datasets. The baseline version, in blue, requires up to 2 times as many nodes as the datasets have triples. Using hash identifiers, here in green, reduces the amount of nodes required drastically. The optimization single entry nodes, here in pink, has a similar effect. Combining both, here in yellow, turns out to be even more effective. Applying additionally the in-place storage of single entry leaf nodes shows in these plots no further improvement. This is due to the metric number of full nodes, but we will see the effect of this optimization in the following slides. In this plot, we compare Tensors using 4 different versions of the hypertrie with other widely used triple stores. That are Blazegraph, Fuzuki, a Fuzuki version with worst-case optimal joins, GraphDB, GStore and Virtuoso. The plot shows how many bytes are required on average to store a triple. You can see that the baseline version of Tensors clearly has an above-average memory footprint. This resulted in our experimental server not being able to load the Wikidata dataset. The other triple store not reported for Wikidata, GStore, cannot handle the amount of resources. Now let's look at the results. Tensors versions are reported with increasing amount of optimizations from top to down. You can see that the memory footprint drops further with each optimization. The most optimized version consumes an average amount of memory compared to the other triple stores. I find it important to note here that Tensors still encodes indices for all possible collation orders, where other triple stores typically trade some indices for storage efficiency. Finally, we verified that the query performance was not degraded by the memory optimization. Well, it turns out it's actually quite the opposite. You can see in the top row box plots of the QPS, queries per second, where the cross marks the average. The middle row reports QMPH, query mixes per hour. Please keep in mind that QPS is more robust to outliers where QMPH drops rapidly with only a few queries taking long. The third row reports the portion of queries that failed. For most datasets, QPS and QMPH increase slightly with each optimization added. DBpedia shows a larger speedup in the QMPH by a factor of 2. The largest impact is visible with WhatDiff. With all optimizations, the QMPH value is 7.4 times higher than without them. Overall, the version of Tensors with all optimizations is at least 3 times faster than the other triple stores with respect to average QPS and at least 1.7 times with respect to QMPH. It has not failed to answer a single query. Overall, the version of Tensors with all optimizations is at least 3 times faster than the other triple stores with respect to average QPS and at least 1.7 times with respect to QMPH. It has not failed to answer a single query. To sum up, we reduced redundancies and overheads in the tensor data structure hypertrie. Using the optimized hypertrie in the triple store Tensors led to a reduction of the memory footprint by up to 70%. The loading times stayed thereby within the typical range of other systems we compared against. The optimizations also led to an improvement in query answering times. Thank you very much for your attention. You can find all code, data and plots to reproduce our paper at the link provided here. If you want to reach out to us after this talk, we would be pleased to discuss with you on Twitter.